The most asked question on Instagram this week was, how long does the coronavirus survive on different surfaces and in the air? John Merlo here says, how long does it last on my clothes and fabric and other surfaces? Does it survive in the air? These are all great questions that we're going to address today.
There has been some recent data that's emerged and also some expert opinions that we're going to talk about.
We just want to point out that this data is emerging and changing on a daily basis, and some of these studies are actually still ongoing. And the date today is March 29th, 2020.
The reason we want to talk about this and the reason that this is important to address is because if we know how the virus is transmitted, then we can reduce these potential vectors and also slow the spread of the infection.
The absolute best thing you could do to help yourself and the community and the people around you is prevention. We need to take the best measures to prevent this. Before we get to that, let's just quickly go over some basic concepts.
So the first question we need to ask is, how do we actually get this virus? How is this transmitted? And that's an important concept to understand. There's three most common ways of viral transmission. One is person to person. You know, you cough, you sneeze, you wipe your nose, and then you shake somebody's hand. The second is you cough or you sneeze, and these particles, they travel several feet away, and if somebody's in that vicinity, they can get it through any of their mucous membranes, eyes, nose, mouth. And the third is on surfaces, and that's what we're going to talk about.
When we cough or sneeze or even breathe or speak, we emit droplets that contain the virus. And not only that, but we also emit aerosols, which are basically liquid particles that have the ability to get suspended in air. So think about it kind of like just the way mist or fog is liquid particles that are suspended in air. Aerosols behave the similar way and contain the virus. And a common misconception is that you have to be symptomatic or ill or actually coughing or sneezing in order to be contagious and transmit the infection, but that's not true. Even before the onset of symptoms, and even after the symptoms resolve, you could still be infectious, and that is through viral shedding. When viruses infect a cell and replicate within it, eventually they're able to exit and get emitted either through coughing or sneezing, but also simple things like breathing or talking. And this can actually happen for up to 3 to 4 weeks.
The first study that we're going to talk about is one that's ongoing and done by the University of Nebraska, where they took a look at 13 patients with confirmed coronavirus, and they took a look at personal items, room surfaces, as well as toilet and air samples. And so what they did is they took a sample from all of these objects, they took it to the lab, and they checked whether there was evidence of the virus on these objects. And what they actually found was that the majority of these objects actually had evidence of the virus, and to be specific here, 76.5% of all personal items were positive by PCR. iPads, eyeglasses, 81.3% positive. Cell phones, we all have a cell phone, 83.3% positive for viral RNA. And television remote controls were 64.7% positive. I just want to note that this is also in the absence of cough. So some of these patients didn't even have a cough, yet the virus was detected.
Another major finding of the study was the results of the air samples. So the investigators collected air samples. Some of them were in the room where the patients are cared for, and others were in the hallway outside the room. And what they found was that 63% of the air samples in the room were positive for the virus, and 66% of the samples from the hallways were positive. Now, the positioning of the sampler and the distance between it and the patients was not defined nor consistent, so it's a bit hard to interpret these results, but taken together, these data indicate that there might be significant environmental contamination in rooms where patients who have the virus are cared for and housed, regardless of the severity or the acuity of illness. Of course, we have to mention that this is an early study. It's still ongoing. It has a limited number of patients and study design. So these numbers may be difficult to interpret, but they give us an idea. All right, so now let's move on to the second study. And this is the one that actually addresses the main question of this episode and the title of the video, which is, how long does the virus survive on these different surfaces? And in this second study that was recently published as a letter in the New England Journal of Medicine, the authors investigated the stability of the virus on 5 different surfaces. And these were aerosols, copper, cardboard, stainless steel, and plastic. And as you can see in the figures here, which are taken from this paper, there is an exponential decay in the virus titers with time. And the authors report both a half-life for each one, and half-life means the time it takes for half of that concentration to no longer be detectable, as well as the duration until which the virus was still detectable, although at low levels, as you can see in the graph here. And what they found was that the viral titers remained detectable in aerosol particles in up to 3 hours. And in copper, for up to 4 hours. In steel and in plastic, the virus was detectable for up to 3 days, 72 hours, and that's a long time. As for cardboard, it was detected in up to 24 hours. So what does this mean? So in conclusion, this means that the virus has the ability to remain viable on these surfaces for long periods of time, going from hours to potentially days. And that means that these surfaces can be contaminated and spread the infection, which reinforces the practice that we've been encouraging everyone to do, which is disinfecting these surfaces. Phones, tables, commonly held objects, and so on.
So what about clothes? The previous two studies didn't address what to do with our clothing, but clothing is made of a fibrous material, and we can extrapolate that this might be comparable to cardboard. Experts do say that the virus can live on your clothing from several hours to maybe even a day. Although experts believe that this might not be a major vector of transmission, if you are in an area where people are not respecting social distancing per the CDC guidelines, it's well advised to come home and wash your clothes. Of course, if you're caring for somebody who might be ill, or if you're in the vicinity of somebody who might be ill, then definitely wash your clothes. But if you're not, then you can follow your general clothes washing protocol, not worry too much.
So I guess we don't have great data to help us answer that question. And you know, there's no reason to panic and overdo it, but when in doubt, just wash your clothes. So if these data tell us anything, it's that not only do we need to frequently and consistently disinfect our handheld devices and iPhones and surfaces and commonly held objects, but also that the healthcare setting is a major vector of transmission of this virus. In fact, some data suggests that 20% of COVID-19 infections are healthcare workers. And that may be in part because there is such a shortage of personal protective equipment in many hospitals nationwide. In fact, there have been reports that stockpiles are so low that doctors and nurses have been reusing masks or asking for donations to get masks or even sewing their own masks. That should never be the case. We need to protect our healthcare workers, doctors, nurses, environmental services, staff and technicians, and everyone in the hospital.
Not only are healthcare workers important vectors of transmission, but we need personal protective equipment in order to keep our healthcare workers safe to protect our community. We need to pull together all of our resources in this healthcare system that is inevitably going to be stressed to its limits.
If all the healthcare workers are ill, there'll be no one left to take care of people. And a lot of these workers are already ending up in the ICU and intubated and even dying.
In South Korea, which has arguably been the most triumphant country on the globe in this war against coronavirus, the general public is walking around of what is a US equivalent of an N95 mask.
And that's a great point, Sharisha. While there may be debate on what the most effective and affordable mode of protection is and who should get it, the reason this is very important, the South Korea example, is that we are so far behind. Our healthcare workers and the individuals who are at highest risk of getting the infection should not be at a shortage of personal protective equipment.
With the quick spread of the novel coronavirus, more questions than answers are arising, and we'll do our best to try to answer your questions every week.
So guys, please remember to stay safe, protect yourselves and your loved ones and your community as we all go through this pandemic. And again, we are not trying to create panic here, but rather we want to advise everyone and give the necessary information on how to take the necessary precautions. As Sharisha said, we're gonna try our best to provide updates on this issue. Please post your questions on YouTube or on Instagram.
Thank you for watching. We look forward to seeing you next time.